Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Ranjith Tharayil. I'm an agile coach in Solutions IQ, a wonderful company. I've got around 11 years of experience in distributed and different domains, starting from embedded, healthcare, machine learning. So it's pretty scattered all around, and mostly I'm a developer, techie. Also, I've played a role of an architect. And currently, I'm an agile consultant in Solutions IQ.
So today's topic, how many of you have heard the name Behaviour Driven Development? Okay, great. How many of you guys are practicing it? Okay. When you hear BDD, you guys have heard it already, what comes to your mind? What are the words, phrases?
Gherkin.
What did you say?
Gherkin.
Gherkins. Okay. I didn't hear. Testing.
I mean, UI technology, so there's a story comes to the picture of what's
going on. Huh?
Story, user story.
Requirements, are you saying?
Yes.
Something like that, sir?
Yep.
Requirements.
Jasmine.
Jasmine. Okay, I give you tools in my plus one. I'm just categorizing it what comes to you. Anything else? Come on. You should not sleep. That's why I'm doing this exercise.
All this different from BDD.
Okay. Confusion. And?
User.
User? Again, I go back to requirements. User. Over. That's it.
Clarity.
Clarity in what?
Clarity in
requirements.
Yeah.
Customer driven.
Customer driven.
Where is customer? Okay.
Customer driven. I still didn't get that keyword. I'm just waiting for that. I got tools, I got testing, I got requirements, I got confusion. So first I'm getting confusion, thanks. And I got customer. So I'm very bad in writing, I'm also dyslexic, my spelling might go completely forward. So just keep that in mind. Variance?
Collaboration?
Testing, again testing. Acceptance criteria, testing?
Expected behavior.
Again, requirements, I put one.
Collaboration?
Collaboration, I like that. I was just waiting for that. Okay, now we can move on. Okay, today's talk, it's a bit advanced, assuming that you guys are practicing BDD, but understanding the crowd, I would definitely take a little bit of introduction. I would spend probably the first half on introducing it, and the second half would be useful in understanding why certain teams failed when they approached or adopted behavior-driven development or didn't succeed as much as other teams in comparison. So this would be probably the structure of the talk. So what are the two questions that you're going to it will be answered in this talk? Is going to be like when to embrace behavior-driven development, or a different phrase of how to adopt it the right way. This is probably that what you would probably take away as a learning outcome from this talk.
Okay.
Jargon, so can you get it? What the hell is this? Criteria. It's written outside in, multiple stakeholder, pool-based, well-defined interactions, agile software delivery, outputs tested, software that matters. Only junk jargons. I hate jargons. Does it make sense now? This is what I just scrambled these words and just asked you if you ever understand. This is what Dan Knott thinks about behavior driven development. BDD has gone through a 10 plus years of inspected faces, and this is what the latest definition, what Dan Knott thinks about behavior. Again, it's a set of jargon, so since we are interested in this, I'll just try to explain it a little bit. Then BDD is a second generation, so anything starting with DD is a second generation. Okay, just keep it like that. Not log-driven development. Okay, that was very premature development earlier time. You know what log-driven development? No, just have good logs and never use a debugger at all.
Logs.
I've done it. Remember it? We had to, because debugging was a costly affair. We used to do a lot. But other DDs, test-driven development, and acceptance-driven, test-driven development, ADD, all are second generation. Outside in, I come to that. We're talking about more from specification by example when you're talking about outside in. Pull-based.
Yeah.
You guys understand pull-based? I'll just explain that later. Also, multiple stakeholders. We are talking about writing specifications in the form of examples. And these specifications are supposed to be read by whom?
Whom?
User? Then?
Developer?
Product owner?
Tester? All the stakeholders.
You got the answer?
Yep.
Multi-scale, I'll come to that later. High automation, you guys know that. Agile methodology, you know that. Describes a cycle of interaction with well-defined outputs. Hold on to that, I'm going to come to that. And resulting in the delivery of working software is pretty well known. Tested software, that matters. So apart from the jargons which I said, hold on, which will you get it clarified later on throughout the entire presentation. You understand what is BDD now a little bit better? Okay? Maybe not. I don't think so. You can never understand by just this. Have you seen this?
Yes.
No?
Yes.
Lot of times.
Yeah.
Done that. Not again. Stop the crap. We have seen this. I saw it first time in. Okay, 2001, great. Even around that time when I was doing my engineering, it was in a software engineering book. And I think it was printed 5 years or 10 years before. So it was there for prehistoric times, the same image. Is it valid now?
Yes.
So this is what probably the customer really needed, and that is what the programmer wrote it. The swing that is lying on the ground, tied around the... Have you heard again the 80-20 rule?
Yes.
We had talk about how Microsoft Word features were used, right?
Yes.
Something similar to that. 20% of what? What is 80-20 rule?
Features.
Requirement.
What is required?
Yeah. 80% of the requirements that we are developing is typically not used or very, very less seldomly used. So we are using 80% of our capacity is going towards mostly towards wastage. This is what the 80-20 rules. So this is valid, you agree on this?
Yes.
In the current context. I have some eyebrows raised, they're saying it's not valid. Anybody? No? Perfectly valid?
Yes.
Not in Agile. Agile also? Not
we are getting a constant feedback from the customers, right? So in that case, you cannot say that if they want to hire and they are getting the support.
Okay. I take it. Hold on. Let us talk about the philosophy. I just got that word from one person. Why the hell we have BDD over here? Or why do people embrace it or adopt it? The main reason behind adopting behavior-driven development is because we have the problem what we were talking about earlier. That is, we wanted to build a swing, tire swing, and we ended up building something else. And the key problem behind it was what? Lack of
feedbacks,
demos.
So
what does it all come down to? One umbrella.
Collaboration.
Collaboration. Okay. It's lack of collaboration, and this is the devil that we have been fighting for a very long time. Okay. This is the why we want to adopt behavior driven development, and it is not because we wanted tested software. So. Probably all the weights should go to collaboration over here. these things are also there. I'm not saying that it's not for that, but mostly we are doing it on primary focus. And what collaboration are we talking about? We have business, we have product owners, we have developers, we have QA people. You know how earlier developers and QAs used to work? They used to fight each other. Even now they fight. Okay. Even though in the agile world also, I'll tell you, they fight even now. Okay. So, but the point I said, in agile world, sometimes you said it all looks very fine. Production support, how about that? The developer team dumps it to the production support guys after, and then it's their own. They have to make sure the system runs. They have to make sure that they have to support it and things work perfectly fine. The developers have enjoyed their entire time right after release. When we look into it, each of these people work actually they're supposed to work towards a common goal, but internally QA people are more interested in generating more number of defects sometimes, because that is what is tied up to their appraisal. So sometimes a common goal goes in this like this, different directions. And this is exactly what we're trying to address in behavior-driven development, is the collaboration factor. I hope that point is clearly said and it's gone into your heart, not to your brain.
So does it mean that if we are not using BDD, there is no collaboration?
I never said that. I said it's one of the tools, techniques. I'm not saying that if you are collaborating well, if you're doing things perfectly well, don't even attempt to do behavior-driven development. Because you're doing things right? Why the hell do you want to change it? Okay, BDD school of thought. But you have to really retrospect, are you guys doing it right? It might look right, might not be right. We talked about a fancy word called outside in. This is what outside in is talking about. Have you heard about specification by example? Specification by example is typically outside in. We first write specifications in the form of examples so that it is more understandable, it is more readable, and people can really comprehend it. Different stakeholders, whether it is the users, the business, the developers. And these specifications, whatever we write, are testable also. Okay? So that's what we ensure in when we do talk about behavior-driven development. And then through these tests, we drive the code. How is traditional development, even in normal sprints, how does it happen? Typically in agile world, there would be a spec, a cloud somewhere, maybe sometimes a 2 or 20 page document, you know how much documentation you guys do. Does the developer read it?
No.
I never read it. I was a developer. First 2 pages, that's it. I like to sit and start coding. I start with the code. Then, if I had following test-driven development, then I start with the test. Okay, assume that I'm not doing it, then I think about unit testing it. Within a sprint I'm talking about it. And then we think whether it matches the spec or not. You get the difference between inside out and outside in. Clear? Any confusions? Here we talk with the start with the spec. The spec is a living documentation. That means it is supposed to be put into your source control also. And this specification can be executed as a test, and this test is what is going to drive your development. And this specification is something that is going to be read by everybody. We said multiple stakeholders, right? Different people. People who are going to use your system, people in the production team support, they all can read, because just written in plain English.
But that can be a user story, right?
The user story is written in the form of an example. Okay. User story need not be written, typically user story need not be written in the form of an example. That's what specification of the example points out. We write it in the form of an example. What is the difference between an example and not? For example, an ATM transaction. I go to an ATM, I swipe the card, if there is sufficient amount of balance, I withdraw, I should get the money. This is a user story. How do we translate it to specification by example? I have an account, it has a balance of $200, I withdraw $50, I should have a balance of $150. This is now an example. It communicates in a better way. Now, banking example everybody knows. But when it comes to your problem domain, right, it's not the banking example we're talking about. It's more complicated. So it relates to the person in a better way. That's why specification example is so important. Okay, so
I think it's not.
So this is how it works out. The business owner and the business analyst have a conversation about what business needs, and the BA comes and presents it to the entire team, which includes the QA, which includes the production people. Anybody who can contribute towards the scenario identification is brought into, and they have conversations. What if this feature is there? So you can have happy parts, sad parts, you know, happy parts, sad parts, exceptional parts. All these conversations, these are like conversations, and these conversations are captured, and these becomes your scenarios. Okay? And then these scenarios are in a testable format so that you can always verify it. The developer, I told you, right, the developer typically spends more time thinking what to write than writing code. And this particular thing helps him directly to understand what the hell he needs to write. His focus is just solution, not problem. That's why we are developers, always be very useful. Okay. In a sprint, just I'm trying to typecast BDD. I'm not saying BDD, behavior driven development, should be always done like this. I'm just taking an example so that you understand, since most of the people over here have not understood behavior driven development in and out. So assume that there are three sprints you can see, N-1 and N+1. Okay? Sprint planning meeting is somewhere there, right?
Yeah.
Assume that the team is following Scrum. So it's assumed that in the sprint planning meeting, your specifications are ready before the planning meeting. Okay? How do you ensure it?
Look at it.
The working agreements, definition of ready,
yeah.
All these words should come to your mind. Okay? If the team feels that they're not comfortable with certain requirements which they have pre-groomed, they have a little bit of confusion, they never pull it. It might affect the sprint goal, or it might affect their planning, whatever it, but they are not confident. That's where the pull base becomes even more powerful. I'm talking about really fully mature autonomous teams. Okay, maybe it is not fully applicable to you guys. You can't typecast this directly to your work. I'm just giving you an instance of how certain teams follow it. Okay. So before this specification should be ready, right? For that, what is required? You need to talk, you need to discuss. You need a lot of discussions, right? So for that, before the sprint, so we are talking about what needs to be delivered in N sprint. Before that, in N-1 itself, you start having discussions called the 3 amigo meetings, or today now it's called the 4th amigo. You include what? The production guys also. So the 3 amigos are who?
Test,
dev, and the 4th amigo nowadays is the production guys. So anybody you can include, not just these three guys, anybody. If a VP is so happy about the feature development and he wants to really contribute towards the scenario making, please welcome him also. We are trying to shape the product, what you guys want to put it in during these meetings. This is what is going to happen, and this is going to take time. And this is supposed to happen with the entire team, because different people in the entire team has got different views. They have seen different sides of the system. So we want a full team participation in these meetings. Typically these meetings are time boxed, say 1.5 hours, 2 hours. What is delivered after one meeting, you see what delivery has happened, how many features, and you don't you just identify the scenarios typically. And later on, you can detail these scenarios into your feature files and things like that. So maybe you need 2 or 3 sessions of 3 amigo meetings based on the maturity of the team. And that happens, and that requires full team participation. Keep that in mind. And that is how you ensure that before sprint planning, you have these specifications ready. And what happens before the meeting, 3 amigo meetings? What should be the discipline typically followed? The PA already has understood what the requirements are. He or she basically presents it to the team with some basic set of scenarios. Examples. Scenarios is examples. Probably this is how the system should work. And then what happens? Then this conversation triggers. So there is a discipline over there also. Before the three amigo meetings, it's something like required that the BA typically comes up with the basic set of scenarios, because you're using an entire team's capacity, right? You don't want them to be wasted. So we just directly want to enter directly and discuss and come up with some productive scenarios. So there is a lot of discipline that is being followed by BDD adopted teams. This is what the line that talks about, remember, cycles of interactions with well-defined outputs.
Yeah.
Is BDD flow or tech?
Both.
Why a tech coach is teaching BDD? If it's
something technical
question,
right? It is something
yes.
Like example.
Yeah.
That's
fine. The why tech coach is thinking, I should probably go and sit here. I'm a tech coach. See, it's a mixture of both, I would want to point it out. BDD is a philosophy. It has got both elements of, because it has got a tooling aspect towards it. But for me, when I look into it, there's a lot of flow aspects. And this is something that people don't really understand, and people really believe that behavior driven development is for testing alone, rather than it is about collaboration and how do you shape your product. That thing is completely masked up. Okay. Discipline delivery, working agreement, this is how you get these things done. You have stricter, but just pointing out, what is so special about behavior driven development? DOR, DOD, working agreement, specification by example, everything was there earlier, right? Okay, they just put all these things into a jargon and they just said behavior driven development, packaged it.
Collaboration.
Why collaboration was
everybody
not?
Everybody is on the
new
same
name
page.
Or something? Nobody has thought
that's
about
like
it.
On the, by example, that's by example
on
the BDD, right?
So we went through a definition, right? Remember. So if you go into that definition one by one, probably you can see that these are some of the best practices what agile teams, mature teams actually follow. So if you ask me what is the real novelty between BDD, maybe there is very little novelty, but the collection of these things produce a very novel result. So that's something that I would like. This is my personal view. You can disagree or agree. I believe it's a collection of practices which mature agile teams typically follow, even if they were not following behavior driven development. There are certain novel things also which will come. Clear? Some people have not understood. Okay, and then you have to laugh, otherwise they feel like you're not understood. Have you heard this?
Yes, I'm not exactly kidding you.
Something similar?
Something.
It's very common, right? You hear it now and then also. Even people who say that we have been following behavior driven development for ages, we know end to end, this is what they do.
We practiced also a little bit of this.
Good. For example, in this sprint, we have just finished development and now we are doing DDD, and after that, we plan to do BDD. What is? Something really crappy. I hate to see something like this. Have you seen this? I'm pretty sure you have it also. If you are, do BDD for Jira 5, 6, 7, 8 or some other user story 1.7. What is doing BDD? What is BDD? You can do something like some like an activity or something and finish it off. It's a philosophy. It's something that you have embraced. It's a way of developing software. It's a way of developing your product. You can't just have a card for doing BDD. People typically write this for writing their feature in Gherkins, which is the language that we typically use to write the specification. That's when doing that. So what I do say is that don't undermine the word BDD for just writing scenarios. Just call it specification writing feature specifications. Some better word. BDD is a much bigger term which requires respect, which we talked about, right? It's talking about a bigger picture.
Okay, some myth busters. You talked about gherkins coming to you. What if you don't have gherkins? We had a bigger definition, right? In that we talked about automation. Probably the tool helps in automation, but the rest of the things, we don't require the tool at all. So it doesn't qualify for you guys to say that I'm not doing BD because I don't have any tool or anything. It's a mindset, it's a philosophy in which you're trying to work. Okay? Tools are not required. We'll talk about it later. BDD is about testing. I got two. Well, not only about testing, definitely it has got a testing into it, but it's more about how can we collaborate better. BDD has to be done top-down approach, only end-to-end. It's a very debatable point that I've written. You don't see that in any of the books right now. We'll talk about it later. First, Liz Kiop, she was one of the members in the JBA. You know J-Hub, JBA? Yeah, you have some question. Yes.
No, I don't
know. Oh, great. She was in the team that who developed it along with Dan. You're from ThoughtBox? Okay. So she was one of the authors, or in fact one of the primary authors of the JBA Behaviour tool, which was the first tool that this was a thought experiment from Dan North, right? So she was one of the first people who actually coded this tool. What does she say? Just Google it and you can find this. She's the person who wrote the tool and she's saying step away from the tool. What happens, right, these days, you give a tool to a developer, he starts to master it. He forgets the philosophy. That's what happens when you start using tools or dive into tools. So typically when I start coaching teams, I say that don't even touch the tool. First get your flow correct. First start writing scenarios in the form of examples. We'll think about tools later because that is more easier to crack. Because it's just a tool, learning that tool and just automating it is easier than getting the first half, your three amigo meetings, full team participation. And sometimes people come into the three amigo meetings and just sit. They don't even talk, they don't open their mouth. Or everybody opens their mouth, nobody listens. So you should get all those things perfected. There are a lot, it's not so easy, I tell you. It isn't about tools. So you're talking from this beyond, she's. Okay, Sebros, who wrote the first book on Cucumber JVM. If you are using Java, probably you might have read this particular book. This is the first book that came out for the Cucumber stack. He tweeted and he was extremely sad in his tweet. You're the person who wrote that book. He's seeing the current state of the art, how people have adopted it, and he's crying, saying that this is not the way. I'm pretty sure, I don't know how you guys in your organizations, how they treat it. Is it only used for testing? Probably that is not what is it intended for. This message has to go. It has to be communicated. If you are scrum masters, coaches, senior developers, this has to go. We are looking into a bigger problem, collaboration. Okay, don't use it only for testing, that's what I'm saying. Testing is an output of behavior driven development. It's a nice side effect, I would call it, which is very useful. I'm not demining the effect of testing, it's going to be extremely useful. But we don't really, that's a byproduct, yeah. I was looking for that word and thanks for it. It's a byproduct.
Side effect is negative.
Yeah, sorry. Byproduct, I revert back, thanks. It's a side of a byproduct. Okay, so what does Liz Kiyok talks about? Can somebody read that loud? It's got a nice sound. I want to ensure that you guys are not sleeping also. Go on. Yeah.
In fact, BDD is not even really about testing. It's just a way of capturing those conversations which happens to provide some test, lift some of the burden on the testers. If you want to run additional performance tests, exploratory test or even record some test, it doesn't have to come under the BDD banner. It's perfectly okay to do BDD and test things
there. Okay, you can have a separate, for testing alone you can have something else, but don't club it together. BDD is for collaboration, it's for shaping your product. It is to understand, are you developing the right product, not the product right. Okay, James Birch talks about testing in a different way. This is how it terms, for example, you can see this is a typical scenario in which we are talking about an account in credit, how we withdraw an ATM card. So it talks about, given this account is in credit and the card is valid and the dispenser contains cash, when the customer requests cash, then ensures the amount is debited and ensures the cash is dispensed and ensures the card is returned. Probably this is what your story is going to look like, typically if you are writing it in the form of scenarios. But if you try to think too much about testing, right, this is what is going to get as an output. You start writing the same thing and then you say, then check that the account is debited and check the cash is dispensed and then blah, blah, blah. You start to write all your checks. What is the problem in writing this? It's good, right? You get it tested.
Dilutes the purpose.
It dilutes the purpose. Who's going to read? Assume that you have documents like this. The whole purpose over here was collaboration, right? If you start writing like this, it's just going to be dumped and nobody is going to read it, even the developer. You remember, we throw away the spec just a couple of minutes ago. It's going to be the same fate. Okay, you remember the test pyramid, okay? Seth and Matt Wayne actually talks about something called as, this is the third myth that we're talking about, behavior-driven development should always be end-to-end, okay? This, and typically from their experience, these are two coaches, by the way, head coaches. By the way, what they feel is that mostly it's going to be end-to-end and service level, that is what it's going to cover. Typically it's going to be heavy on the service level side, that is a center one, acceptance level side. But even if there could be tests that could verify components in isolation, some things that you are only used to write UTs, right, you can still, for example, what is an example for that? Assume that you have to have a risk calculator engine. A risk calculator engine standalone has no use, right? It always collaborates with some other components. Some risk calculator engine, customer risk calculator if you are in banking domain or something else, or some calculation engine. But how this calculation has to be done is known pretty well by your business. Am I right? And this is exactly what we are talking about. So the business knows it and they know how this calculation engine should work. So you can have only scenarios for this calculation engine. It might not be integrated fully. When such and such things happen, this is the way it should behave. This could be what is written. So it need not be end-to-end is what I'm talking about. But mostly 90% of the time, it would be heavy on the integrated components or subsystem, and sometimes very less onto end-to-end. Why you want less end-to-end?
Less time taking.
More importantly, less time taking is one factor, but I would put it like end to end, we're talking about GUI and DBs. These things are frequently going to change. And your core business logic lies in something what is more centered. That is what you want to test. Even you don't want, without your GUI and your DB, you can still check your core business logic. And that is what your system's behavior should reflect. Today it might be in a web browser, tomorrow it might be in a mobile, day after tomorrow it might be voice commands. Does your business logic change? It's something that's remaining constant. So we typically be more heavier on the service leg, that is the center one. Okay, so the bits are again, this is the biggest myth. So they come up with that, okay, let us have BDD, we want teams to work. They see that no. We have to use our own brains. You're talking about collaboration, right? Collaboration comes when we think only. It is not just because we have put BDD into picture, it doesn't think, it's not a silver bullet. Second part. Have you heard or read about the problem space theories? I'll just introduce that. I told you, right, developers like to think only what?
Code.
Solutions. You just talk, okay, you want to do this, they start coding. That's the mindset difference that I'm talking about in the two spaces. We have a problem space and we have a solution space. Typically, engineers, developers, all are mostly, again, it's a mindset boundary, reside in the solution space. They like to be, they are much comfortable. Whereas your product owner, your business, your product designer, BAs, they are mostly in what? Problem space. And they think about the problem. And there is a gap that is always there. And this is what typically creates the problem, what we saw in the swing problem, remember? That's what is the real problem. And BDD is one of the techniques to try to address this. You asked me, right, is BDD... Oh, she's not listening.
Sorry.
It's perfectly fine. You asked, is BDD the only technique? No, maybe there are other techniques. It's one of the techniques to bridge this gap. But it is found more effective. Another thing that we have to understand is that typically when we talk about complexity, about a story or a product complexity as general, we don't split it into problem space and solution space complexities. It's together. But these independent spaces have their own complexities. Okay? For example, assume that there is a team that has been developing e-commerce applications for the past 5 years. And they've been asked to develop a small shopping cart application. Okay? It's a piece of cake for them, right? They've been developing that for 5 years. A simple shopping cart application is something they feel that both the problem space and the solution space is going to be simple for them. Park it. We take the same problem, move it to a team that has only developed embedded software. How are they going to handle this? For them both, again, the problem space and solution space are going to be complex. The point I'm making is that this particular thing is very context specific. Okay? Now assume that the same development team, the embedded development team, after 5 years down the lane, they find it the same, you're given the same problem, they're going to find it much more simpler. Both in these spaces. I'm going to give an example in which the problem space is simple and solution space is complex. Okay? You know an image? In an image, you can easily identify objects. You can easily segment it out because our brain works perfectly fine. Try writing an algorithm for that. It's easily describable as a problem, right? You know that. The problem is very easy. This should be like this. This should look like this. This should be segmented as a monkey. This should be a phone. This should be a car. Here the problem space is much more simpler, whereas the solution space that you're entering, you're going to have novel algorithms to solve it. So you understand the complexities could be different in different dimensions. The dimensions are problem space and solution spaces. Assume that you're developing you're in healthcare, you're not an expert in healthcare domain, and you're developing some algorithms for an entire MRI suite. Healthcare application suite. Both the solution and problem space are going to look complicated for you again. So you get that feel, right, when I say that these two have its own complexities. Based on that, you can put your stories and your entire product into four different quadrants. Getting it? Where the x-axis says problem space complexity. If it's low, it's on this side. If it's high, it's on this side. Also, you have a solution space complexity which goes bottom, that is on the y-axis. So most of your stories or any of it will fall in one of these quadrants. So that is something that you guys understand. So I'll just go ahead. I don't have time to play this game. So I typically what I do is that I ask them to develop a 10-level card. Levels of card. Pretty simple, right? Could you explain to me? This is just 4 levels. If you make it 10 levels. Another one is I got his Uno cards and I asked them to arrange it as exactly as this is.
Okay.
And these are product development, they're just simulating. This is a Lego game which I asked them to develop a plane and this is a pencil. The rule is of the games are like this. Initially, there's going to be 3 sprints. In the first sprint, the product owner, I am the product owner, and I would have identified a BA in the team also. I will come interact with him for a minute, and the BA can interact with the team for a minute, and the team is given 10 minutes to develop. During the time, the team can't talk to BA. There is a constraint on collaboration and imposing that. In the second sprint, the BA gets 2 times to interact with the team, one in the start of the sprint and one in the mid of the sprint. Okay? In the third sprint, both the product owner and the BA is available throughout. So this is how it's simulated. When you look into the complexities, right? Card game, the tower of cards. How is the problem space? You know pretty well. You need to develop it, but the solution is going to be complex. It's going to take a lot of time and a lot of effort from people. When you talk about the plane, it's going to be complex in either both the parts, both solution and problem space. Because developing that plane from a Lego block is not so easy. In this particular game, you can see that once the problem is identified, you just need to arrange the cards. The solution space is simple, but you need to know the problem, otherwise your arrangement is going to for a toss. Over here, both are low, that is a pencil. What has been observed in that game when you start playing is that in the first sprint, this is cracked. Okay, probably no much of collaboration, without much collaboration, you get that right. In the last sprint, this is cracked, because there is pretty high collaboration and they come up with flying colors. Within 5 minutes, they come up with saying the solution. Till then, they were struggling. The other, about two, you can see the plane coming, looking, coming into shape, but typically they don't complete it. What the point, takeaway point over here is, when your problem space is complex, it makes more sense to spend more time in discussing and debating. We talked about collaboration and behavior driven development, right? We talked about 3 amigo meetings. If we are using the same amount of time and effort towards problems which are having low problem space complexity, because we're using the entire team's effort, right, in discussing and making, you might not get the entire ROI. Probably you, if it's low in problem space complexity, you have to move fast. You're getting it? So you have to identify this complexity, and identifying this complexity is the most important aspect and the most confusing one. Because there is something called as second order ignorance. Second order ignorance exists when I don't know that I don't know something. This happens, right? Once you start really doing it, you understand that. So if you ask me how the hell do I really understand how complex these things are, inspect and adapt is the only way that I can tell you. There is an approximation in which Liskiog in his blog had pointed out. It's a very high level approximation, you can start with that. She talks about points, rating it. If just about everyone in the world has done it, that means it's something one. Assume that a story or a feature, this is. Lots of people have done it, including someone in our team, it's 0.2. And someone in our company has done this or have access to expertise, it's 3, and it goes on like that, the complexity levels. You need to spend more time in your 3 amigo meetings whenever you see something is greater than 2. Otherwise, you just write the scenarios, everybody is happy, you just go forward. Don't waste time discussing, debating it. That's what I'm pointing out. Typically, teams come out and say that we don't find value in behavior-driven development. One of the reasons is this. You're getting it? You should understand the problem-based complexity. Just assume that you were sizing these products. Which one would have got Excel? Or double Excel? Maybe the plane would have got double Excel. The cards would have got an Excel. So you would think that probably you need to spend more time on the cards than the plane. But spending more time on the cards might not make sense because the problem space complexity is low. So you have to spend more time on the solutioning part. And you have to take this one and that one to spend more time to elaborate your, to understand the problem. Because once the problem is understood, the developer finds it much easier to develop. That's what we are trying to do. And also we are trying to shape the product. Okay, so this is my last slide, and we are ending on this. three key points that we have to focus on in scenario identification. Functionals is something that I've been talking about. Everybody knows. You have to think about your constraints of the system. You have to think about quality attributes. What is an example of a constraint of your system? Assume that your system cannot support more than 1 billion users at a time. That is a constraint. What the hell should happen if there is more than 1 billion users? That is the behavior that you have to identify. Remember Flipkart? Anybody from Flipkart? Sorry, it's okay. You are there? Okay. Probably they didn't do this exercise. Otherwise they would have got that. And typically, you know who comes with such questions? Ops guys.
Yeah.
They have been living with it. They have this question naturally. That's why I say you have to include them also. Quality attributes, what are quality? Performance is a quality attribute. A transaction should not take more than 3 milliseconds. It could be a scenario, it could be an acceptance criteria. You don't think about this. It might come otherwise as an enhancement to you that it is taking more time or as a defect. You capture it during a 3-hour meeting, then you know that if you do the fix later, it's going to cost you a lot.
Okay.
Questions? How was it?
Very nice.
Okay, this is events from Solutions IQ. So we have a coffee talk, we have Agile technical group, we have an Agile leadership meet, and we have an XP conference. I'm more interested on questions.
The slides will be shared later.
Yes.
So how is this different from ADD?
So I didn't answer that. Anyways, what do you do in test-driven development? What is the focus in test-driven development?
Even test-driven development, the team collaborates and they write the test scenario.
Okay. So any product owners over here? You said you were BA. Do you read their test anytime? Do you understand JUnit? Oh, she understands. She's
because I was a
developer.
Tester,
okay.
And then.
All right. So you have a non. Can you show this test to your business guys? Would they understand?
No.
Can you show it to your users?
No, probably they don't understand the test cases, but they can understand the scenarios, right? So what we do in ADD is we write the test scenarios like what you mentioned. Again,
you're talking about ADDD, right?
Right.
ADDD is also a subset. Okay, you are in the same line. And that behavior-driven development, you saw the entire definition. There is a lot of discipline also involved in that. So it's something more than that, but you can call it as an instance. But it has something more also.
And I'm noting, ADDD only talks about the acceptance criteria. Only focus on that. So that is from the your PO or the you are writing those industries. And when we are talking about BBD, it talks about the scenarios which has been actually evolved. During that collaboration among the developers, testers, they will provide their own perspective on those, right, that something is missing or something could be added to it.
General more visibility across all the stakeholders.
Not only the visibility, but it's the whole scenario will be written.
Everybody
will collaborate for that, come up with those scenarios.
What is the difference between TDD and BDD? This is it. TDD is technology facing, are we building the product right? This is what it answers. BDD is business facing, are we building the right product? Okay, those are pretty similar, but the meanings are completely different. Are we shaping the right product? After the end of the entire production release, we say that nobody is using it. That's what BDD is trying to address. Yep. Something similar. Okay, thank you.